best week. Everybody's hands should go up because we've all been blessed. We're here this morning. Praise the Lord. Our first song this morning, Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us, is one of my favorites. And we have the words up on the screen this time. Five forty-five. Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us. They're coming.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tenderest care. In thy pleasant pastures feed us, for our use thy folks prepare. Blessed Jesus.
545. 545.
Thine we are. Blessed Jesus. Blessed Jesus, thou hast taught us thine we are.
Do we have the songs? No? Okay, sorry. Keep on going. 545. Okay, 545. Here we go.
By thine do thou befriend us, be the guardian of our way. From sin defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus,
thou hear us when we pray.
My God.
Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, O hear us when we Thou hast promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Thou hast mercy to relieve us, grace to cleanse and power to free. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee.
Amen.
Our next selection is 547. That's 4547. Be Thou My Vision.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best, O Lord, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my light. Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true word. I ever with thee, the way, O Lord. Thou my great Father, thy King of heaven,
and I with thee one.
Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and treasure
victory is won. May I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Amen.
Amen. There's been kind of a theme going on. We had Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, be thou my vision, and our final song this morning, He Leadeth Me, 537. You kind of catch that? Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, be thou my vision, He leadeth me. Amen. There was a purpose to that. 537. What's that? Yep. Amen. 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 537, He leadeth me.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, onwards with heavenly comfort draws. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. Sometimes it seems of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's flowers bloom. By water still or troubled sea, still 'tis His hand that leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp my hand in Thine, nor ever murmur, nor repine. Content whatever He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Amen.
Amen. Happy Sabbath. We're happy that you're here today.
Well, good morning, good morning, and a happy Sabbath to all today. It's so nice to see all of you. Want to welcome everyone who was who braved the rain, and you decided to show up here in God's house. I want to welcome Ellen and the family as she has brought her, I think it's her grandkids or nephews or something. All right. So, well, look at that. What a missionary you are. The parents bringing their kids to church. Amen. I want to welcome Brother William, who has been just hanging in there. And as soon as he is here, because he chooses to be here, he's a brand spanking new member of the Johnston Seventh-day Adventist Church. Want to give you a great welcome, Brother William. God bless you. I want to welcome him. Let me see how good I am with these names. We got Sister Vanzetta, Sister Angie with her son, Matt. We got William. We got Maxine and Jackie with Jordan. All right. And we got Brother Michael, Brother Bruce D. And we got Sister Margie, who just walked in. We got Elvira with us this morning. Good morning, sister, with her son. Gianni, I believe. I didn't call you Giovanni. I called you Gianni. Amen. Amen. We got Ernie. We got Brother Bruce. We also have my wife, Pamela. We have Brother Sam. We have Ingrid and her daughters, Emily. And I'm going to have to, I owe you the other name.
Emily and Caitlin.
We got Eric. We have Bruce and his wife. We have in the kitchen, I believe, is Sister Hisel, if I'm not mistaken. And we got Ray Ellen in the back controls. Welcome, everybody, this Sabbath. All right, women's, we're going on to announcements now. We got women's ministry. It's the fourth Friday of every month at 6 p.m. at the church. And this next coming Friday, April 26th, women's ministries, that's for all you women out there. You know, come and help out the women's ministry. We have a bread baking class coming up on the 28th of April at 9 a.m. from 9 a.m. To noon. And just in case I forgot your name, Sister Ivana, I haven't forgotten you, okay? Welcome to you too. Amen, amen. At any rate, okay, so don't forget, and you need to register with Pamela. Register with Pamela.
I have to have registration because I need to know how many that's to prepare for.
All right, there you heard it right there. She needs registration. So if you come ready to make some bread and eat some bread, I hope you register. Amen. We got Youth Vespers the second Friday of every month from 7 to 9. If you are 19 to 99, I hope you are there. The next chance to join is May the 10th. And I will tell you from my own experience there, hey, we have fun. We got good music. And it's an opportunity to see how other youth from other churches, opportunity to meet people as well. We have the blood drive, May 19 at 9 a.m., at the Wickford Seventh-day Adventist Church. We also have the Peru mission trip. We have the mission trip to Peru, June the 20th to July the 2nd. If you are interested in going to Peru, then... And so please contact Brother Michael Chung. If you have any questions, there's also a reference to the SNEC camp meeting, and the theme is I will go. So I'm wondering how many are going to go to camp meeting. All right. And so we have speakers such as DeBlair Snell, and we also have Pastor Randy Roberts from Loma Linda, and also John Bradshaw from It Is Written will be at camp meeting this year. I also want to remind you that here at this church, I have a class every Sabbath at 2 o'clock, where we have been basically sharing how to live an evangelistic lifestyle, an evangelistic lifestyle. Okay. Also, you know, the Bible says that there is joy in heaven over every sinner that repents. More joy than the 99 that think they need no repentance. So next week, if you want to see what's making heaven happy these days, I invite you to come and witness the rebirth of yet another child of God. There will be a baptism next week. Join us for Margie's baptism after potluck.
Amen.
That is April 27th, next week. Okay. It also speaks about May 4th. Also, don't forget that the first Sabbath of next month, we have a district-wide meeting in this church. We're going to have the whole district of Pastor Yason and Maxine, the whole district, i.e. all of the three churches, right here. So if you haven't been to Burrellville, or you haven't been to Wickford, or you haven't been to Johnson, I invite you to come next week. You can go ahead and see your brothers and sisters from all three churches here. Okay, yes. Of course, you know, bring something to share with your brothers and sisters.
Also, next week is going to be like ethnicity week, where everyone can wear their garb.
Not next week, 2 weeks.
Oh, I mean the 4th. Yes, I'm sorry. I'm getting the baptism confused. Yeah, on the 4th. Everybody bring garb from your country that you came from, or maybe your background even. I mean, I'm Scottish, but I don't have a kilt, so forget about that. But but also bring food from the countries of origin, so we can all share with each other. Okay.
All right. Thank you very much. If I'm missing anything, I did an ancestry thing with me, so I guess I can dress up Spaniard, African, Taino, Indian. I got all kinds of options of how I can dress up. Anyway. Happy Sabbath once again, and welcome everyone. I hope that you are enjoying this day with the Spirit of God.
Good morning, happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters.
Happy Sabbath.
Okay, one more time. Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters.
Happy Sabbath.
That's happy. See?
Amen. Amen.
That's not happy. Ah, yes, happy. Right? Who's happy to be here?
Amen.
Amen. All right, if you take out your hymnals and turn to 272. Give me the Bible. Stand, please. Time for tithes and offerings. They go for the local church budget, the loose offering. And I have a reading here. Smells can bring a flood of memories to your brain. A special family recipe can spark a whole host of thoughts and emotions as it passes through your home if someone is making a meal. I got to stop there for a second because I thought when my wife is making rice and beans and she starts the rice, Ziva lives upstairs. And all of a sudden you hear the footsteps come flying down the stairs, because the house is very old. And she knocks on the door and comes in and she's like, is somebody making rice? See? And she's going to remember that for the rest of her life, right? It's truth. There are recipes that my mother and my grandmother have made that still brings me joy when I get together and they are cooked for the family. One thing I am still mastering is the art of making good bread. I love the smell of fresh bread, homemade bread, and it is always something that I look forward to making. Pam, did you write this? Because yeah. What has brought even more joy is involving my children in the baking process when it is possible. Baking and cooking are skills that can be taught and learned. Similarly, our church has a rich heritage of passing along the lessons we know in order to build up the next generation. The Bible encourages teaching and sharing what we know, and the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others, 2 Timothy 2:2. Ministries such as Sabbath school classes help us connect and better know the recipe for a better life in Christ and how it practically live out our Christianity outside of these church walls. Today's offering is for our local church budget, which supports ministries such as Sabbath School. May the deacons please come forward and collect the tithes and offerings, please. Okay, boys and girls, Cruz Maria, I think she's got a good lesson today, so make sure everyone comes up for this. Come on up and take your seats, please. Siva.
Thank you. Can you hear me? The story today is about Sarah and her daughter. We got six girls here today. Wow. Sarah loved her daughter, but Anna was not obedient to her mother. She was disrespectful. She didn't like to do what the mother said. And one day, her mother asked her to help her with the dishes. And she's saying, "No, mommy, I want to go and play with my friend next door." So the mother said, "Okay." So the mother rolled up her sleeves and started washing the dishes. Then Anna saw her arm and she said, "Mama, why your arm is so ugly?" And she says, she stopped washing the dishes and she says to her, "Come sit over here. I want to tell you a story." And then she started telling her that one day when she was a baby, she put her to take a nap and she went and started doing something, you know, making something to eat. But at the same time, her friend next door called her and says, "Come over. This is very important. Come over." And she went to check the baby, and the baby was sleeping. And she said, "Okay." So she went because it's right next door. And then, I'm sorry. Then she started talking to her friend, and then they started hearing the fire truck coming. Fire truck coming. Louder. Yeah, and it was getting louder and louder. And then she looked on the window and she saw that there was the fire was in her house. And then thank you. And then she went inside. No, she didn't go inside. She went, she tried to go inside, and the firefighters, they tried to stop her, and she pulled them out. She pulled away, and she went inside, and she got the baby, and she wrapped her in a blanket, and she was trying to go out. And when she was going out, I forgot to show you the pictures. This is the house. And then when she was going out, you know, she saw the house was on fire. Okay. And they were trying to put down the fire. And then, what is the bin? You know what's a bin? One of those big pieces of wood that they put on top of the house to hold the house. They have a second floor, you know? Okay, so I don't know where it went. So it was on fire, the bin, and then it was gonna fall on both of them. And then she tried to stop it and she got all burned up. And it was really, really bad that her arm, she couldn't expose it because it was really bad. So when she told Anna that, Anna started crying and she said, "Oh, mama, You got hurt because you tried to save my life. And then she said, for now on, I'm going to do everything that you tell me to do. And then they both started crying and hugging and kissing. Okay. Now, you know who died for you? Who died for you? Jesus died for you. And you know that he's coming really, really soon? Yes, he is. And, you know, in the fifth commandment says that children, you should honor your father and your mother so your days will be long in this earth. Okay? So we have to obedient to our parents. All right? And, also, when he comes, we're going to see the scars that he had in his hands. I couldn't bring the picture. It was too much for me to see those scars hands. So one day we're going to see the real hands, everything that he went through for us. Okay? So he loves you all very much. And we need to be prepared to receive him, okay? So, let's have a word of prayer. Let's bow our heads, close your eyes. Yeah, Heavenly Father, we thank you, my Lord, for everything you're doing for us, for everything you went through for us, that you love us so much, my Lord, that you came to this world to save us. We thank you for your salvation and your redemption. We thank you for all your blessings, for all your goodness that you bestow upon us. Thank you, Father. And we pray that you be with the children, my Lord, all these beautiful girls that you have here, that they will continue to get to know you better and be a good vessel for you in the future. Thank you, Father. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
It's time for prayer intercession. This world is growing old like a garment, as we all know. And if we read in Matthew 24 and 25, we see Jesus' warnings for us that he was giving his disciples for the future. I'll be going down, Sam. I'll be going down doing it myself. Thanks. Yeah, thank you. So I think we're all going to have a lot of things to pray about. Because the way the world is, the way our families are, the way government is, everything.
I just want to ask you about Thank you.
Thank you. So if you have any prayer requests, I will go around with the microphone. And anyone? Oh, get down there a minute, Angel. Vanzetta?
Thank you. Asking the church to pray for my friend. She just texted me that her mom and her father-in-law were just placed in hospice.
Coming down through the back. Be there in a minute, Bruce. Let's do the Sally family. Here we go.
I'm requesting prayer for Tanya. I'm Tanya, requesting prayer for my family. My great papa just passed away on Wednesday, and we have the funeral coming up on Monday, and it's a little overwhelming.
I have special prayers for my sister. Her husband is in hospice, and he's not doing really well at all. He's struggling to breathe, and the cancer's spreading right through his body. But he don't want to give up his independence. So he's struggling. He's really struggling. And I pray that my husband's leg heals better, you know, really soon, because he's also struggling with walking. And yeah, you know, we're not sure what it is, so that he's going for an MRI. And prayers for me, because my back is really starting to bother me all over again. And I'm struggling to even walk. But I do praise God, because today I have all three of my grandchildren here with me.
Okay.
Yep. So that's, to me, that's a blessing all in itself.
Yeah.
I just can hope that they continue in this path.
I'm going to make my way back. Angel left.
Happy Sabbath, church. I'm requesting a prayer.
Jackie.
For my daughter, her name is also Jackie. Hopefully she'll find a home for her and my grandchildren. They're homeless right now. So, yeah, please pray for them. And this is my granddaughter, Jordan.
So happy she's here.
We all are, yes. I saw Bruce Dunham. Oh, hold on. I have to go here first.
Yeah, happy Sabbath. My request would be apparently Israel still, you know, with practicing their bad habits on refuse to do the right thing. So my request would be that whatever outcome it came out after, you know, in this war, because United States advised Israel not to attack, but they ignored that advice and they just did it. So hopefully God keep us in good standards, you know what I mean? And whatever comes after this, you know, situation, they just ignite.
Bruce Dunham.
I'd like to ask for prayers for our older veterans and our older citizens. I learned a couple of times this week that as children get more and more successful, there's less and less time as they start their own families. And I had one guy who was very proud of his children in my van, but he was nearly in tears because even though they call him, he never sees them anymore because they have their families and their families have their issues. So I'm asking prayers for him and people like him. I'm asking prayers for my mom, Delia, and Cynthia. My mom and Delia are having health issues. And with my mom, they keep getting other information. They say, oh, that's interesting, but it doesn't seem to have anything to do with what they're looking at. Delia is getting a little bit older, and 104. She'll be 105 in December. and she's just getting tired and she's getting worn down. And Cynthia is doing the best that she can to support her, but she's just getting overwhelmed. So I'm asking prayers for them.
Happy Sabbath, Church. I'd like to thank God that Nick's here with us today. And, you know, and I'm so thankful that God answers prayers.
Amen.
Yeah, we need prayers for all our family, for Robert, me, and Nicholas, and my oldest son, Anthony. Anthony's looking for a job that he got to decide what to do. He got two offers. So for him to make the right decision.
Sam has a better memory than me, so I like to go to Sam.
Good morning, Church. My name is Sam. I'm praise, thank the Lord for this Sabbath because my car broke down almost 2 weeks. Now I get the part. I'm going to fix it Mondays. Praise the Lord. Yeah, I go to another auto repair, they refuse, and I go back to another one. It's okay. Monday, I hope it's good. And I request pray for the people at home, and like Barbara's and her husband, and Margaret Ewood, and David Hura families as well, and Effie Snow, and Pat, Candy Moss, and Chris, no, not Grisali. Grisali here. Yeah, it's good.
Is that my granddaughter? Ziva.
I would like to have a prayer request. Oh, no, the praise, my bad. For that, my friend Eliana is here.
Amen.
No. Amen. I'd like to pray for all our children, grandchildren, as we very tough world to see children here. And praising the Lord is a great answer to prayer. Remember to claim that promise in Isaiah 49:25. Yes, 49:25.
Good morning, Church. Last weekend, I had a really stressed and also my mind was really disturbed because somebody was very unhappy with me. And when I came in the church, the praise team sang a song called Trust and Obey. Yeah. And I did sing with alone, and I tried to listen to the word and sing. And I really told myself I should trust my God and my Lord that He's gonna take care of me. And I prayed throughout the weekend, and on Monday when I went to work, that person was very happy with me. Yeah, I was just amazed. And God answers the prayers like that and the quick. And again, when we trust the Lord, He's going to take care of us. Amen. And I want to thank you for the praise team for that, sing that song.
I think Bruce Dunham. One more. Bruce Dunham.
I forgot to ask for prayers for the Cumberland Church. I will not be here next week as I will be attempting to preach at the Cumberland Church. It is a church that desperately needs prayers as it is dying. If you are looking for someone or something to pray for during the week, I would greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Nicholas Calvino.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I just want to praise God for getting me through, you know, the month and bringing me here. It was pretty hectic, and bringing me, to where I am right now, to this seat. And I praise God for that, bringing me with my family together, with this church family. And I just praise God for the love, and I praise God for bringing me to this moment. And I also ask for prayers. There's a couple things that are stacking up for, in my life. And I ask for prayers that for help.
Praying church, powerful church. We have Eric, people online.
Yes. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. From our live stream, Sister Rosa is asking for prayers for her mother, who suffers with neuropathy pain daily. She asked for prayers for her sons, and continued prayers for her sister Jackie. Sister Barbara says prayer of thankfulness for all the blessings God does provide, for he is faithful. And for me, praise for my mother's continued recovery. She sent me a fairly long note, so I'm going to try and grab some details here. She starts physical therapy at home next week, but she's still having trouble walking. She's looking forward to having enough strength in her legs to get upstairs to her actual bed. She's been sleeping in a recliner the last couple of weeks. She has follow-up appointments in a couple of weeks. Prayers for my dad, too, because he's been extra stressed dealing with all this and helping mom and being her legs and arms, essentially. She does, however, wish to give thanks to all of us here for the prayers that we've been sending her way.
I wanted to mention something I want us to all to pray over, if we could, please, and that is the sign. It's very embarrassing to me to be a sign man since 1981 and have this church sign look so terrible. It's been reworked so many times that it's wore out, and it's hard to screw the tracks that hold the letters back down, and if you move them, hard to understand, but if you move the tracks to rescrew them in a new place, then you're going to have holes in your sign, look like it got shot. So we had a company, Vincent and myself had a company look at it. I know it's business, but it's evangelism. And we had a company in Putnam near our house, and we gave them all the survey for the sizes and all, and they just totally never called us back. So we, after months, was like, what happened? And they said, oh, could you resend us the information? And we were just like, so we have to go a different route because that's not where we need to go. So I'm wanting to get the parts myself because I could put the whole thing back together again with new faces, new tracks, new everything, and LED lighting. Where do you find the time to do such a thing? So, and to go get all the parts I need. So that's where I'm struggling with now, and I need prayer and guidance on exactly how the Lord wants us to go. A LED sign like you see down the street and only a $40,000 and only have a 10-year warranty. So that's out. But to redo this sign, we could probably do it quarter of that. So, I spilt my guts, but yeah. So please pray for the right way of taking care of this, because we have messages that need to go on that sign. Is there anything else? And Yvonne said, thank the Lord for who he is and for his word. Thank you. Also, last week we had three anointings right here on the stage. We had Jackie, because she's struggling with cancer right now. Probably, maybe not anymore since we had the new anointing. But Ellen and Yannick. So I want to give the invitation. If there's anyone that's sick, anyone that's feeling like you've fallen away, anything like that, the elders, we're ready to do an anointing anytime after potluck, any day, today, whatever, to do anointings. Okay. Now, you don't do anointings like every week, because that's saying, God, I don't believe you, the first one that you even listened. And we want to make sure, you know, God did hear the anointing. So we don't want to do the, all the time, the same ones. But we have faith that, of course, God hears this in prayer. Yes, Elder Shetsem. Okay, sounds great. Yeah. Before everybody leaves. Okay. Amen. All right, sounds great. All right, let's all kneel where possible. You know, come to the front if you wish. I'm going to be over here. Anybody that wants to come up here and kneel and or wherever, whatever's comfortable for you, if you can't kneel. Abba, Father, your children are gathered here, Lord, praying before you, Lord. And Lord, you know our hearts, you know our minds, you know more about us than we know about ourselves. And Lord, we just ask that you show us what your will is. You've heard the requests, Lord, all the requests, and the ones that are in our minds that are private ones, Lord, that you know of, because you know everything. But I think it's about time we ask what you want from us, that you're not some Santa Claus that just comes and gives gifts, Lord, that you are the Lord of and God of the whole universe, who created everything and knows every little cell, every hair on our head, everything about us, Lord. And we give ourselves to you. We surrender to you, Lord. And we want to be used for you, young and old. And so to show us what you want us to do, Lord, to build this church, to build your church, to do your will, to help people as we pass by that we don't even know need help, that you guide us to that person and help them and maybe save their lives. Lord, we come before you, your throne with power, and we ask these things in your name, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thy ear to us and grant us thy peace.
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
Happy Sabbath.
Today's scripture is going to be found in the book of Jonah, 1 verse 17. And before I begin, I would just like to say it's nice to see Nicholas in here. He is a brother, a friend of mine. And I would just like to say it's nice to see you in church today.
Amen.
So in the book of Jonah, 1 verse 17, it states, "Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights."
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Oh, everybody's sleeping. Oh, no. Let's try that again. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Okay, that's a little bit better. We need to be awake and joyful on the Sabbath, right? Amen, because God is a good God. This is a song that I learned at a women's retreat in Florida in 2013. And it quickly became like an unofficial theme song for me and for us. It's called Work On Me, Life Under Construction. It's written by a woman named Gail Murphy that I had the pleasure of meeting at some meetings in Alabama a couple of years ago. And how many of you know what Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says? Right? I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, and give you a hope and a future, right? How many of us claim that promise? Amen. But how many of us expect the plans to be exactly what we want and exactly when we want it? We have problems with that sometimes, right? Because we have a plan and we're pretty sure that God has the same plan and the same timing of things. But that's not the truth. And I'm grateful that God doesn't have the same plans for me. I have no idea, but God knows exactly what. So this song is called Work On Me Construction.
The plans you have for me, you know the way I cannot see. So help me be patient while my life is under construction. You have a purpose and a plan. You hold my future in your hand. So help me be patient while my life is under construction. Work on me, until you are satisfied. Work on me, till I become what you've designed. If you have to tear me down to build me up, I will place my trust in you. Jesus, work on me until your work is through.
You have a plans you have for me. You know the way I cannot see. So help me be patient while my life is under construction. You have a purpose and a plan. You hold the future in my hand, in your hands. So help me be patient while my life is under construction.
Work on me, until you are satisfied. Work on me, till I become what you design. If you have to tear me down to build me up, I will place my trust in you. Jesus, work on me until your work is through. Work on me. Until you are satisfied, work on me, till I become what you've designed. If you have to tear me down to build me up, I will place my trust in you. Jesus, work on me until your work is through. Sabbath work on me until your work is through.
Jesus, work on me until your work is through.
Philippians 1 verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
I know we've done it already, but I want to extend once again a welcome and greeting and salutations and warm hugs to everyone here today. I especially want to pause and say welcome and a big hug to my uncle, Carmelo Calderon. I was completely surprised. I didn't expect, my uncle to be here. Once again, welcome everyone. It's always a pleasure to be in God's house on his day of worship. And I only get to do this once a week. I have a once a week date with all of you. And it's a privilege, a joy to be with you here on a day like today. I would like to invite you now to please join me in prayer. Please pray for me. Lots of what I will share basically all comes from the Word of God, but I didn't write anything. I didn't rehearse anything. This is purely, I didn't write anything. So if I want to know what I said, I'm going to have to look at the video afterwards. So this is purely from God's Word, and whatever he decides to download to me today. So I have no idea how many bling blings I will have, but I'm just asking you to please pray for me right now. Father God, thank you so very much for this moment. Thank you that I get to share this moment with your children here today. Please hide me under the shadow of your wings, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Her name is Bonnie. She can pull a trailer behind her. She can house or sleep six, if you're a couple. She can give you water. You can go to the bathroom. She'll take you from here to the all the way to the West Coast if you want. She takes us camping. She allows us to cook. She keeps us warm if it's cold outside. Oh, she's such a nice being, this Bonnie is. As a matter of fact, if you want to take a look at Bonnie, all you got to do is go to the back of the church. She's been with us several years now. And as a matter of fact, Pamela and I even lived with Bonnie for a whole year. We were what you might call full-timers. But you see, it wasn't like this. I did have the dream of owning a motorhome. But I did not dream I was going to get it the way we did. You see, I was early in my career, and I had dreams, and I was just, full of desire and enthusiasm. And I had graduated, from school just recently. Don't trip. Da, da, da. Oh, nice. And all the nice fanfare, all of the graduates from the Master in Divinity program at La Sierra Adventist University. And oh, I was also full of joy and enthusiasm. When am I going to get my first pastor job? I had finished the required preparation, at least at the time in my dream, on my way to become a chaplain. But you had to be a pastor first. I mean, I don't know of any cardiologist who just went straight into cardiology without first becoming an MD. And so here we were, Pamela and I, we finally got our first call. Ah, yes, they told me in school that whenever you receive that first call, Victor, you always say yes. And so like a faithful and enthusiast, young, full of spunk and energy, I of course said yes. Even if it was just an interim job, Stephen. Well, I figured I'll go ahead and do the interim thing, and then they're going to see me, and they're going to say, well, you know what? I think we want to keep you. As a matter of fact, I basically was told, you know what? You got the first dibs at this. I think we might keep you. And we hit our first church, you know, we hit the ground running, as it were. As a matter of fact, my wife had a full-time job at Loma Linda University Hospital, working at the OB, obstetrics. And I, while I was going to school. And so when I got that first call, boy, I said, oh boy, yeah. Yes. As a matter of fact, we moved from our nice apartment house, and we left the nice full-time job, secure job at Loma Linda University to go to this church. Something I had never done before. Only in the Bible you can look it up. And the only one that actually lived in the temple that I could hear of was a priest and Samuel. You remember that story? And so we took off full of faith and cheer and everything else to our church. And we actually lived in the church. We lived, Angie, in the church. As a matter of fact, we stayed in my office, and we had a cot and this and that and the other. And we would begin to do ministry in the neighborhood and connect with the people and walk the neighborhood and do all this. But just a few months later, when it came time to vote and to see who was going to be the pastor, that's when I come to find out they already had somebody in line. They already had someone they're going to put in there. And before I knew it, we were out on the street. No full-time job. No Loma Linda. You got the degree, but you're still outside where the degrees are cold. And so we ended up not quite homeless, but basically there. We stayed in a tent. I began to feel my brethren and sistren who out there in Tent City. And we stayed in a tent, Michael, until God, who had already planned, he introduced Bonnie. The title of today's message is When Bad Things Are Good. When bad things are good. You see, it was a pretty bad thing to be out of a job there, Steve. It was a pretty bad thing to not have a place to live and to have our things, of these worldly goods in some kind of box storage thing. But you see, God had prepared. He had prepared a 23-foot motorhome Class C for Victor and Pamela. And yes, it was more than 3 days and three nights, but you know what? It kept us. While he had the other thing planned for us. I ask you to please open up your Bibles today in the book of Jonah as we look now in God's word that we see and we find here an instance of when bad things are good. This is what we're looking at today. It is time for you to open your Bibles. I hope you didn't come to church without a Bible. Ay, caramba. That is like going fishing without your rod. You be out there in that boat at that nice lake, but you can't catch anything because you don't have a fishing rod. You don't come to the church without your Bible. I mean, come on now. Everybody should be opening up their Bibles right now. I have nothing to show you on screen. I have all to show you in the Word of God. Going to the book of Jonah, chapter 1. The book of Jonah, what chapter did I say? The book of Jonah, chapter 1. Roberto, chapter 1. All right? Amen. All right? I'm glad to see that your son is here. Amen. How you doing, Nick? I am so encouraged. I got this warm thing in my heart right now. It's got Nick's name on it. Amen. All right? Amen. All right, here we go. Jonah chapter 1, the Bible says, Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for the wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish. From the presence of the Lord, he went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare, because this was not free, and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God, small g, and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. All right. So the captain came to him and said to him, What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God, big G. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish. And they said to one another, Come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us. So they cast the lots, and the lot fell on, guess who, Jonah. Then they said to him, Please tell us for whose cause is this trouble upon us. What is your occupation, and where do you come from? Where is your country, and what people, and of what people are you? So he said to him, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, Why have you done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord. Why? Because he had told them. Did you see that? Did you look at it in your Bibles? All right. Here we are, verse 11. Then they said to him, What shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us? For the sea was growing more tempestuous, and he said to them, Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will become calm for you. Notice what the verse says. For I know that this great tempest, this great what? This great tempest or storm is because, notice the reason for the storm, people. This tempest is because of me. Nevertheless, the men rowed toward hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Verse 14, here we go. I hope you're keeping up. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, we pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. Okay, I have just read the text in front of you. You've heard me read the text. You saw me read the text. And you hopefully were following with me in reading the text. So if nothing else, you've just read 14 verses of the Bible. And if you haven't read the Bible all week, congratulations, you just read 14 verses on the last day. I have four learning points to share with you today. How many learning points? Just four? Just four? Four learning points to share with you today. Learning point number one. What is the name of the topic today? When bad things are... Okay. Learning point number one. There's always consequences when we decide to go in the opposite direction God tells us. Shall I repeat that for you? Learning point number one. There's always, that's the like the opposite of never. There is, Kenny, always, Kenny, consequences, Vanzetta. There's always consequences when we decide to go in the opposite direction God tells us. But despite the fact that the prophet of God, aka Jonah, despite the fact that he went in the opposite direction, Angie, the opposite direction than God asked him to do, we see here that there's always the bad, but there's always a good. The bad is the fact that there was a storm at sea. That would be the consequence, Brother Steve. According to the scripture read today, verse 1 says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. It doesn't say the word of his dad, Amittai. It doesn't say the word of the of the pastor. It doesn't say the word of the deacon. It doesn't say the word of his mother. It says the word of the Lord. Now, it is so true that you're going to hear the word of many people throughout the week. The word of the of your earthly boss, the word of the supervisor, the word of any, the cashier, the register. There's so many words that we hear throughout the week. But according to the scripture says that it was the word of the Lord that came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. En otras palabras, In other words, in the language of heaven, when the word of God comes, it comes to you, and you have a first name and a last name. Here we have Jonah, the son of Amittai. It wasn't just any Jonah. It was the son of Amittai. So when the word comes to you, you are the daughter of somebody. You are the son of somebody. You are a specific person. And when the word of God comes to you, you are responsible to respond. Our learning point number one, the bad is the storm at sea. What was the good that came out of the storm at sea? Amen. We have the storm at sea, and then we have ultimately, due to the storm, we have a converted crew. We have a converted crew. Now, Jonah obeyed or disobeyed God when the word came to him? Jonah obeyed or disobeyed when the word of God came to him? Disobeyed. Go ahead, you can say it. Jonah disobeyed. The prophet disobeyed. Here we have an example of a disobedient prophet. Hello. Here we have Nicholas, a disobedient prophet. And something bad happened because of a disobedient prophet, right, William? There was a storm at sea, buddy. There was that storm. And according to the narrative, that ship was getting ready to be broke up. That ship was, that storm was tearing that ship apart, Matt. That's right, I'm talking to you. Homeboy looking at me like, you talking to me? Yes, I am talking to you. That storm was ripping that ship apart. As a matter of fact, the narrative says that the ship, the crew of the ship, they were throwing stuff out. There's this luggage. It was, oh my good pants. Get out of here. I don't want your pants anymore. They were storing, oh my good, your whatever. Oh, GQ, so get out of here. They were throwing stuff in the water, William. They were throwing stuff in the water because they were trying to stay afloat. You ever had so many things that you had in your garage and then all of a sudden you had something that was so valuable, Roberto, so valuable. Oh, I can't throw this away. Next thing you know, years and years go by, and then you have a garage sale, and guess what's being sold for $3.50? What you paid dearly a few, but hey, how much you want for that? Come on, give me an offer. We have what I have called, we have here, what I have discovered is command, reaction, and consequence, or CRC. We have God's command, we have the prophet's reaction, and then we have the consequences. That's how it is in life. God gives us a command. It is up to us to react in a particular way, and there will always be a consequence. Always. God told Adam, son, you can eat out of everything up in this garden up in here, except this tree over here. If you eat from it, you're going to die. So I'm just letting you know, don't eat from it because, I don't want you to die. The Bible is clear. They could eat from everything. Everything, including the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It was a choice. It was a choice. If you didn't have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they would not be free. they would not be free. Okay? So we have what I have called CRC. We have command, reaction, and consequence. Learning point number two. Here we go. Learning point number two. First of all, what was learning point number one? my external drive. I tell you what, amen. I forgot the minute I read it, I forgot it, but then I can turn to my external drive and, we're good. Amen. Well, let me go ahead and say it, read it here, because I do read the memory verse. There's always consequences when we decide to go in the opposite direction God tells us. That's learning point number one. Learning point number two. People, get this, Kenny, oye esto, brother. People are not really interested. They're not really interested in you until your life decisions affect them. Learning point number two. Okay. How many learning points do we have today? All right. We're halfway, so you don't have to look at the clock. Learning point number two. People are not really interested in you. Really? I mean, come on. Hello. Until your life decisions affect them. Here we have Jonah in the bottom of this ship sleeping. Boy, man, he was a guy having siesta. He was that siesta. Nothing was waking him up, Angie. I mean, he was good, man. He was good. He was not worried. I mean, he's God's prophet after all, Michael. Disobedient, but hey, you're still God's prophet. Amen. And here he is at the bottom of the ship. And then all of a sudden, according to the narrative, the captain of the ship said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will listen." Huh? Then all of a sudden, all the questions came out. Sister Yvonne, where are you from? Where are you from? I mean, what church you go to? What's your religion? What's up with you? All of a sudden, they want to be all in your business. Now they're interested in you, Jackie. When your life decisions affect their life, Chris. I mean, there you have it. You know? Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation? And where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you from? We want to know now. I mean, how many times you don't know anything about whatever artist, all of a sudden some horrible things happen and it's all over the news. And now all of a sudden, oh yeah, you know, they went to this school, they're from this, they're from this. And all of a sudden you're learning all about this person you absolutely knew nothing about, but because something bad happened, and it affected, you know, folks, all of a sudden you know all of their business. They want to know all about you now. People are not really interested in you until your life decisions affect them. What I am wondering is, how many people around this church building will have their lives affected positively towards a future, an eternal future in heaven, because we're making decisions that are going to impact the community around us in a positive way. And then they will be interested in who you are. I've been to several Pathways to Health, to Health events, where a Pathway to Health event is one of these huge mega health fairs where they have surgeons and eye doctors and dentists and what have you, and massage. And I mean, they have, I mean, they just rent like a whole coliseum, and you have people attending for 3 or 4 days at the tune of like 2,000 people a day, getting free health care for about 3 to 4 days, about 2,000 people a day, getting haircuts, getting surgeries, getting general surgery, getting dental surgery, getting eye stuff, getting surgery on their skin, getting all kinds of medical care for free. And then you got people asking, Yoon, why are you guys doing this? Where are you from? What church you go to? Why, what's going on? I want to learn more about your church. I mean, why are you guys doing this? I mean, nobody does this for free, Sarah. Nobody does it for free. She's nodding, consenting. Yeah, yeah, who does it for free? I'll tell you who does it for free. God does. God gives you life. Every breath that you take while you're listening to me is a gift from God. Every single time you wake up in the morning is a gift from God. He gave it to you. Wait, I said it was free. Maybe I need to retract my statement. It did cost something. It cost all heaven in the life of Jesus. I take it back. It was not free. It's free to you. We're talking about when bad things are good. The bad thing that happened in this second one here is that the terror and the fear of loss, they tried to save themselves. You remember in the narrative, they were rowing harder and harder. Come on, guys, everybody, come on, try again. They were trying to save themselves, trying to save themselves. Row, row, row. Come on, we can get to land ourselves. And the narrative, you read the narrative, remember? You read the narrative. It said that the sea and the storm grew more tempestuous. En otras palabras, in other words, in the language of heaven, the more we try to fight and struggle to save ourselves, the more the devil has power to torment you. The more you make it about yourself, the less God can do. But when we bring the boss into it, then he can stand up in the boat filled with water, almost sinking, and say, peace, be still. You see, when you got the boss in the boat, I don't care how wet you is. I don't care how wet you are, how tired you are of rowing. When the boss is in the boat, there is no way you can sink. Unless you jump ship. Then I hope you have a good life jacket. And as long as you stay in the boat with Jesus, it's safer. It's much safer. As a matter of fact, isn't there a story in the New Testament of Paul, how they got shipwrecked? Huh? You guys remember that story? Huh, Chris? You remember that story? That, you know what? They did get shipwrecked. They did get shipwrecked. Your life might feel and might seem, your life right now might feel like you're shipwrecked. But according to what Paul said, he said, don't try to get out. Don't try to get out. God told me we're all going to get there. We all gonna get there. Boy, if I was living with somebody with a connection to the boss like that, I wouldn't leave him out of my sight. I'd be like, yo, Paul, what did he say this time? Hey, what's the word, man? Oh, you know, we gotta stay here, and then, you know, oh, okay, fine. Okay, let me just make sure I got my little life thing here, but I'll stick with you, okay? But for those who try to row and row and row and you're trying to save yourself, good luck. Was that you saying no thanks? Trust and obey. That's right. Amen. 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 Learning point number three. Learning point number three. Before I share learning point number three, let me just quickly share with you. We got chapters. The book of Jonah's got four chapters. In the first chapter, it speaks about Jonah's disobedience, the storm at sea, and how he gets thrown in the water and all of this. Chapter two, he's saying his famous prayer from inside the belly, from inside the belly of this big, big fish. In chapter three, he gets another chance, and the Bible says that the word of God, it says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, it says, the second time. The second time. That's chapter three. And then chapter four speaks about how upset Jonah was that after he preached, they didn't get toasted. After he preached. What? You mean to tell me after I told him 40 days, I've been waiting 40 days. Here, I was down to the fifth day before the 40th countdown, and I'm over here. I got myself a nice little spot over here on this mountain right here, and I have repaired myself this and this and that. I want to have front row seats when this fire comes down. Boy, I don't want to miss this. I don't want to miss this. He over here. He was over here ready to see this city burnt down to ashes. I just told you about the whole book of Jonah in like, what was that? I don't know. Was that 30 seconds? I don't know. Is somebody counting? All right. Okay. So, but here we go. Learning point number three. In chapter two, it is interesting. At the just at the end of chapter one, it says chapter one, Jonah 1:17. If you're looking in your devices, if you're looking in your Bible, because it's good to follow along so you can feel like you into it. All right, here we go. Jonah chapter 1:17. It says, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. Just like God prepared Bonnie to swallow Victor and Pamela for over a year. And here we were in the belly of Bonnie. And so we was safe. And as long as she's parked back there, I know we ain't homeless. I'm not worried about, our lease. Okay, Bonnie, here we come. The Bible says that the Lord had prepared a great fish. It says to swallow Jonah. Hey, I don't know if you read that. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. Learning point number. I heard somebody says it sounds familiar. Some of y'all been in the belly of some fish. I know some of you are feeling like you've been swallowed by your present circumstance. Before we pray to God from the belly of our fishy situation, be comforted that God prepared the fish for your good and protection. That situation you thought was impossible. That situation where you're thinking, oh, how did I get myself in this mess? Be assured, my friends, that God prepared that fish for you. The bad? Well, obviously, Jonah found himself in the fish's belly at the bottom of the sea. I mean, I don't know how many of you have woken up any day of your life saying, I am going to go out here on the Atlantic. I'm going to go out here on the sea. I'm going to go out about 5 miles and throw myself in the sea out there in hopes that I get swallowed by a fish. I'm not sure if anyone of you ever has, woken up with that desire. I don't know how many of you have woken up with the desire to find yourself in a situation you did not ask for. I don't know how many of you have that desire, but I'm telling you, the Bible says that Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the fish's belly. Bling, 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 flash download. It doesn't matter what situation you're in, you can always pray to your God. Well, somebody's excited about what I just said. So that's the bad situation. The good situation is that according to the Bible, after Jonah prayed from the belly of the fish, and if you read chapter 2, you see how he describes that experience. But after he prayed from the belly of the fish, underwater, down to the very deepest depths of the sea, the Bible says that the Lord spoke to the fish. En otras palabras, we didn't practice that guide, but that's exactly what I meant. I tell you, when you got an external drive, Michael, boy, I tell you, it's good. And the two shall become one. Vanceta. So we have a good and a bad. And we have our learning point number 3. Before we pray to God from the belly of our fishy situation, be comforted that God prepared a fish for your good and protection. After Jonah prayed and after the fish spit him back out, after he went back and this time he did listen to God, credit to Jonah. Amen. You know, you had to go in the water to do it, but you know, whatever it takes to get you to listen to God, God will do it so that you will ultimately be blessed. After he prayed, after he was delivered, after he went to Nineveh and he preached the message that God gave him, after the absolutely incredible revival and conversion process that was seen not in one person, but in a complete city, beginning with the king, after all of that, that he was up on that little mountain there, up on that hill, waiting to see the city destroyed. After he got so upset with God, so upset with God that he told God, you know what, God, you know what? Look, isn't this what I told you when I was running away? You remember that, God? You remember what I told you? I knew this would happen. I knew you, God. I know how you are. Don't you remember, God? I told you this. I knew, according to the Bible here, for I know that you are gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness. This is what I told you before when I was running away to Tarshish. God, don't you remember what I told you? I just knew it, God. I knew that you are full of kindness. It says, one who relents from doing harm. That's the kind of God that we serve here, my friends. That's the kind of God that even when he says, look, you know, he isn't like, God is not like some of these parents. A la una, a las dos, two, number three, a las tres. These parents that count to 100 and the child is, he's looking at you to see, you know, what number is going to, you know, finally going to come down. Hey, no, you are count worth nothing. Keep on counting. A las dos, a las tres, a las cuatro, a las cinco. And you never deliver what you say that you're going to deliver. No wonder we got so many spoiled kids. Not God. Not God. God don't be counting. Yeah, God does a little counting. According to my Bible here in verse 1, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. Then he told him what he was supposed to do in verse 3. But Jonah arose. You know, God says, arise, go to Nineveh. Jonah is like, Jonah arose, but he didn't go to Nineveh. In verse 3, it says, but Jonah arose to flee. In verse 4, it says, but the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea. One verse after the but Jonah, the next verse is, but the Lord. He don't be counting. Learning point and last. I told you it was just 4 learning points. Never forget God's character in the midst of your troubles and apparent chaos. Never forget God's character in the midst of your troubles and apparent chaos. Our lives feel chaotic. Never forget what Jonah told God. Didn't I tell, isn't this what I told you when I was fleeing to Tarshish? Don't you remember? This is what I told you. For I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. That's my 4th and final. There's so much more to learn from the story, Steve. But I just went ahead and just got 4 learning points. And so now, my friends, I believe that we're living in a period of Earth's history when I believe that God's church must be brought to its knees. And as you listen to this, if I'm not sure if I... Okay. I believe with all my heart that God's church must be brought to its knees, because it is on our knees that we will gain the victory. It is on his knees that Jonah was able to pray from inside of a fish. It doesn't matter what situation you are in. If we are on our knees before God, he will relent from doing harm according to the scripture. And so as you hear this song, I want for you to reflect on the fact that a city like Nineveh was in fact forgiven because they changed their ways. And it is, I am going to say that as you listen to this, if you feel that God is wanting to bring you to your knees, if you feel that you need to turn back to Christ, I want to invite you, as the Spirit leads, to go ahead and join me in prayer.
This is a picture of a scene that is going to take place someday in heaven.
That's right.
At the throne of God. You see, you can't change your past.
That's right.
But you can determine your destiny by deciding for Christ. And when you do that, Christ changes your past. He wipes out all the sins of the past.
If you gotta start somewhere, why not here?
You can start here, my friends, right now.
If you gotta start sometime, why not now? If we gotta start somewhere, I say here.
This is where it starts, friends.
If we gotta start sometime, I said,
y ahora.
Choose you this day, not tomorrow, this day, whom you're going to serve. And many of you are going to have to decide tonight what is the number
right
one
now.
Priority in your life. All the way through the Bible, choices, choices, choices.
Tonight's choices. The night.
the night. For the sinners and the saints.
For the sinners and the saints. If you think you're a saint, there's a chance for you. If you think you're a sinner, there's a chance for you. Right now. It's all love tonight. When we step across the line, we can sail across the sea to a city with one king, a city on a God's people are pictured as a city on a hill. A city on a hill. Are you in that city? Come now, my friend. Come now.
He's alive tonight. He's willing to come into your heart and change the direction of your life and give you a peace and a joy that you've never known before.
Listen
and
to
the
voice
ask
of
me why I continue
amazing
to preach.
Evangelist.
And I answer because the word of the Lord has come unto me. And he tells me to go and proclaim his gospel as long as I have breath.
Has God's word come to you today?
Through the fog, there is hope in the distance. From cathedrals to third world missions. Love will fall to the earth like a crashing wave. Tonight's the night.
Don't wait till tonight, friend. It's time for you. Are you a sinner? Are you a saint? The word is for you. It's time to step across the line, my friend. It's today, right now. We only have one king. Come now, my friend. Come now. Come on.
A message of repentance, yet the people of Nineveh believed his message. And the Bible says that the greatest revival, the greatest evangelistic campaign in the history of the world took place in Nineveh. It was a city probably
of
600,000 people, and
all
the whole
of San Francisco,
city from the king
they all said yes to God.
Down.
How many said yes to
repented.
God? Oh, tonight gonna last forever.
It's not going to last
we
forever, folks.
And God had mercy upon not only the king, but all the people, and all the people were saved.
Thank
that
you,
can
Eric.
Happen here.
Tonight's the night.
It's the time now. Tonight is the point. God offered his mercy and forgiveness to a whole sinful city. That same forgiveness, that same attitude of mercy, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, that's what's present here today. I would like to say a prayer for everyone that everyone here, but especially for everyone who feels the conviction of the Holy Spirit. If you feel that conviction today, please, please come to the Lord.
I want Jackie's come here and Alan and Nicholas.
Okay. All right. Will Sever. Okay. We're going to go ahead and say a prayer.
Yeah.
All right.
And then I want him, I want her, near North. North is a strong room of God. You need to put the strong room of God. Yes. You can return to the North. Yes.
All right. All right, we're going to go ahead and say a prayer. Okay. All right. Come on forward, folks, that we can feel the warmth and the power. Come on forth. Father God, we come to you today thankful for your mercy, for your kindness, for your forgiveness, for the power and life that is found in you. Lord God, our lives have been a whole lot of bad. But we admit today that you have poured into our lives also a whole lot of good. I pray, Father God, in Jesus' name, that you may please today transform, heal, bring back to life, those who have been dead in trespasses and sins. Oh, Lord God, you see your church. We request, Father God, that even if we have to be thrown into the sea, we know that you have prepared a fish for us. Father God, I pray for three things to be experienced with those who have come forth today and those here, that they may experience your presence, that they may experience your power, and that they may experience your peace. Lord God, thank you so very much for this opportunity. Give us an opportunity to go and preach the word you have put in our hearts. And I pray that the same type of transformative power seen in the citizens of Nineveh will be seen first in your church and then in our community and our families. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Theo. Theo. Psst. Theo.
Bad one.
You just gotta keep going for it.
Open up your hymnals to 309, please. Such a fitting hymn for this moment. I surrender all. 309. We'll sing our hearts out. Stand, please.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender. Surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly at his feet. I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender. Make me, Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior.
to Jesus I surrender. Now I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation. Glory, glory to his name. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, Father God, thank you so much for being present with us today. Please bless and guide your people. Please dismiss us from this place, but not from your presence. May everyone in this building and in the hearing of my voice experience your presence. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.